In the far-off town of Koka, a great battle is raging. Warriors and knights work together to fight off a gruesomely destructive army of demonic creatures known as the Yoma. Knights and warriors all alike get getting slaughtered and eaten by these very creatures.
Don't let up! We can still push back!
The mercenary gets pierced through the back. A bloody hole is seen through where his heart should be. The knights look on in disgust as one of these creatures is in the middle of eating the mercenary's heart. The group decides to attack.
Damn you, monster!
A splatter of blood flies through the air as screams of the group can be heard. Another knight on the battlefield then falls back in fear, looking up at the horror of the creature slowly making its way toward him. The creature then looks down at the knight with a malicious smile, the blood of others dripping from in between its sharp teeth.
More sheep for the slaughter!
No!
In response to the sound, the knight looks up, only to see the creature looking forward in a daze. After a slight delay, the creature is sliced horizontally in two. The knight continues to look on in confusion, as he then notices a figure jumping over him, charging ahead at the creatures. The knight witnesses what appears to be a silver-haired man wearing a black short coat fighting off the Yoma, using his sword to slice through them while also releasing magic blasts from the palm of his left hand.
Pick up the pace, Elena! There's a reason you're known as the Quick Sword!
The knight then hears commotion coming from behind him, leading him to look back.
You know.
Elena then instantly swings her sword countless times in mere milliseconds, delaying the damage before the creatures stagger and then are chopped into smaller pieces.
There are times when I prefer to be slower.
The knight looks on in utter shock at Elena, not noticing three creatures jumping toward him to attack. The creatures are then swiftly split into two, simultaneously by a strange-looking whip.
Bicker no more, my friends!
The knight then looks to see an odd man with a whip enter the battle, using it to easily render the creatures in two.
Are we not here to vanquish monsters? You best keep to the Yoma.
Spare me the prattle.
The knight witnesses the convergence of the three warriors, staring at them in awe.
Incredible! A party has arrived! The tides have turned! For Koka, in the name of Midland!
The knights all stand together alongside the party, pushing back against the creatures now identified as Yoma.
Yeah!
Just then, the cheerful knight is run through by the tip of a giant halberd. Everyone, including the Yoma, stop fighting, all distracted by the sudden arrival of a new individual. This individual then tosses the knight's body off of his halberd, revealing himself to be a large figure on a horse, donned in an armor reminiscent of a snake.
A snake, Baron! He'll deal with the party.
The two laughing Yoma are then cleaved in two from a single swing of the Snake Baron's halberd, shocking even the party.
I despise the sin of sloth. I prefer wrath instead. Wrath is much more than active display.
He just killed two of his own men. Like it was nothing.
Brace yourselves. A Lord of Koka is not to be underestimated.
Smart and swift. You are clearly the strongest among the party. But I must confess, I'm quite surprised to find a claymore acting independently. No matter. I'm sure you'll provide adequate entertainment.
This fight is mine.
Elena steps forward, her blade ready in hand.
Perhaps when I'm finished with you, I'll claim your body for myself.
Elena begins to grow angry at his words.
After all, How many men can say they've lain with a claymore? What? Damn it!
Guess we ran out of time before he got here.
Huh? Before who got here? Answer me! As silence filled the air, the sound of footsteps could be heard. Knights and warriors began to step out of the way of the mysterious individual, calmly walking toward the center of the battle. The two men of the party looked back, noticing the arrival.
Oh, great. He finally got here. Is he always this fashionably late? More times than I can count.
After passing the two party members, the individual, wearing a strange type of armor and harboring an odd sword with the head of a dragon molded on its hilt, steps forward.
This is my fight. Don't interfere.
I think not. He bears a dark artifact, one that would make your hunts seem like novice training.
What? How did you...
The individual then walks past Alina, much to her annoyance.
Damn it, Baran!
As Baran stands before him, the Snake Baron begins to analyze him.
And what, pray tell, are you?
I am simply your doom.
I can certainly not underestimate you, seeing as it appears you are responsible for that magic that has depleted my forces. So it feels only right that I reward you.
The Snake Baron then pulls out an oddly egg-shaped artifact. The artifact then begins to reshape itself into a face, followed by its screaming and shedding tears of blood from its eyes. Just then, a wave of dark energy is released, engulfing the Snake Baron. The Yoma surrounding the battlefield all yell and cheer for what is about to happen. As the energy dissipates, a horrifying ripping sound is heard at the same time as a scream from a horse. Suddenly, the horse of the Snake Baron is thrown in Baran's direction, each piece of the horse passing and landing behind him. From the smoke emerges the Snake Baron, now in the form of a demonic serpent creature.
What do you think of my magnificent form? Granted to those who serve the fabled God Hand.
I know nothing of this God Hand, but I can tell that this battle is already over.
Such arrogance. Allow me to show you how feeble it is!
In an instant, Baran strikes the Baron's stomach with a single punch, causing him to spit out blood from his mouth. The Baron then staggers, taking a couple steps back.
What? How can you?
Perhaps since you've graced me with your true form,
Baran then grasped the hilt of the sword on his back.
I should reward you with my blade.
With a mighty pull and swing, Baran unleashes his sword, a wave of wind unleashed from simply pulling the sword out so heavily. Eerie silence fills the battlefield as the knights and warriors, Party, and even the Yoma, look on in anticipation. The Snake Baron looks around, almost waiting for something.
Well, are you to strike me or not?
Whatever do you mean? This battle has already ended.
Absurd! What nonsense are you?
In a delayed reaction, a wave of blood is released from a newly made cut across the Baron's torso. It was official. The Snake Baron had been cut in two without realizing it. The Yoma all look on in shock and horror as the Snake Baron's two pieces fall to the ground with a crash. The Snake Baron looks up, breathing aspily, as he stares into the cold eyes of his opponent looking down on him.
Who are you?
Baran sheaths his sword.
You were so pathetic and weak. I don't believe you deserve to know my name, even in death.
Baran then raises his finger to the sky, the party looking on a bit worried.
We should back it up a bit.
Baran then throws down his finger.
Zappo!
From above, a large strike of lightning comes down onto the snake baron, followed by the electricity spreading to the remains of his army, causing great pain to the baron and the yoma. In a bright flash, the snake baron and the yoma are obliterated in the electric explosion. As the light dims, the party and army of knights and warriors look on as the battlefield is completely empty of the enemy. Not a yoma or even the snake baron in sight.
He's done it! We've done it! We've defended Koka!
In this dark era, the world is ravaged by war. The empires of Athwan and Yshrinia continue to clash, catching many other countries, continents, and kingdoms into their crossfire. However, all is not lost, for Murius, Queen of Athwan, foretells of three legendary warriors that will appear to turn the tides of this war. These legendary battles would forever be known and forgotten as the Dogma Wars.
Are closed as he is currently having a flashback. One of him in the ruins and flames of aims of a fallen kingdom, looking around in abject horror of the destruction. He then looks up through the flames to see a silhouette of a long-haired individual, triggering Baran's anger.
Damn you!
Baran!
Baran looks forward to notice a particular girl peering into his room.
Oh, Arietta. Cassius summons me?
All on-field Mobile Corp members are to meet in the control car. That's all Cassius said.
Baran stands up.
Perhaps I will finally partake in a mission that provides a challenge.
Baran nonchalantly passes Arietta, causing a worried expression to show upon her face. A moment later, Baran and Arietta enter the control car, walking toward a meeting table with the party, along with the rest of the Mobile Corps in attendance.
"I'm sure you're all wondering why I summoned everyone."
"This had better be good, Cassius. I wouldn't want another waste of a mission like Coca."
"I didn't see you complain and when you accepted that bag of gold from Coca. So quit your griping, Baran."
Baran just looks away, annoyed at being talked down to.
"That's enough, Cien. Have a new request brought about us. We're headed for the kingdom of Lucis."
"Lucis? I've heard of that kingdom. Stories say its ruler, King Somnus, is a pretender and usurped the true king of Lucis. Others also say the one who was supposed to be king was in actuality a monster in disguise."
"This talk of monsters is making my blood boil. Are we to hunt this so-called monster king?"
"On the contrary, Leon. We have a guest."
From the shadows behind Cassius emerges a hooded man, who then takes off his hood to reveal his dark pink hair.
"Cassius, who is this?"
"If I were to guess, I'd say he's the client. Not the first in-person request we've ever had."
"You're correct, Seda. This is Arden Lucius Kylum." Everyone looks on in shock, other than Baran, Seda, and Leon.
"You mean the usurped prince himself?"
"Cassius! You bring a supposed monster of the dark in the midst of the Mobile Corps?"
"Calm yourself, Leon. He's no monster."
"Not in the least. While I possess the power of the Lucius Kings, I am no monster to speak of."
"Then what exactly is your request of us?"
"My request is to overthrow my brother, Somnus Lucius Kylum."
"Somnus Lucius Kylum? Current ruler and possibly single king of Lucius?"
"You'd be out of luck, I'm afraid, m'lady. Somnus is happily married."
"Aww."
"You're still leaving out the most vital part. Why would we help overthrow a noble king? If I am to recall, the kings of Lucius are chosen by their sacred crystal. And as the stories say, you were not chosen."
"My intention is not to take the throne, merely take him off it."
"He's expecting, isn't he?"
"Ah, a perceptive one. Yes, his beloved is expecting to give birth any day now. This is why she has been transported to a secret location to give birth, as have many of the children of Lucius have been before me. This leaves my brother at the castle to attend his duties."
"Now I understand. You were waiting for his heir to be born before you decided to make your move. This isn't an overthrowal, it's a takedown, which makes it personal. So why exactly is it important he's brought down?"
"Are you familiar with the Star Scourge?"
"I've heard tales of the Star Scourge. It's said to be a cosmic plague, and that there have been theories about its origin, even in Faria. But we aren't certain."
"The Star Scourge is a plague that has been infecting the kingdom of Lucius, turning them into beasts known as daemons. Not traditional demons, but demons of their own species. Arden used to possess a more humane method of healing its victims, but since his ascension to the throne, Somnus has been killing the infected civilians. While I understand my brother's choice, he cannot accept that there are better ways. He's too set in his ego. Therefore, I've little choice but to employ those of the Mobile Corps, the top mercenary organization in all of Terra. And so, I'll be deploying both main field teams for this mission. Arietta, Shimori, Cien, and I will act as the frontline team, ensuring we take all the heavy damage, since our Optimus forms will protect us. Then there's the escort team, compromised of Baran, Leon, Elena, and Seda. You will be in charge of Arden's protection."
"Have we missed something? If he's not planning on taking the throne, why must we escort him?"
"It was per my request.
I must settle things with Somnus myself. I can fight just fine using my powers as one of the Lucius bloodline. We should face little difficulty. Baran just stares at Arden, pondering something in his mind. Baran then turns around and leaves the control car.
Very well. Let me know when we arrive at our destination. Till then, do not disturb me.
Arietta just looks on and at watching Baran leave.
His chroma. It shines as red as a noble knight's. Yet why is his nobility covered by sorrow?
As Baran enters an empty cart on his way to his quarters, Baran begins to sense something.
You continue to haunt me like a phantom. Why do you persist when I've warned you time and time again?
Just then, a hooded figure in a particular black coat steps out of the shadows.
And as I've mentioned, I'm here to ensure you follow the correct path.
My path is of my own choosing. Be gone with you.
Baran begins to walk away.
I'm also here to ensure you aren't getting the raw end of your deal. After all, he is known as the god of death for a reason. He promised you your vengeance, but not your memories. Your memories are the key to ensuring you follow the path you were summoned for. Is that not what you want, Dragon Knight?
You appear to know what I am, and therefore, who I am. So why not just tell me? Or easier enough,
Baran grasps the hilt of the sword on his back.
What's to stop me from forcing the truth of my identity out of you?
Neither of us could if we tried. All I can say is that if you were to kill me now, you'd just delay an inevitability. Until then, even killing me as I am now, I would simply appear again sometime in the future. Death cannot touch me in the way it wishes, hence how I am the only one who can guide you.
You've still not told me why you can't simply tell me my story.
That is simple enough. It's because your story has yet to reach its greatest turning point into molding you.
Into what?
Into what you were meant to be.
The hooded figure then reaches his hand out, a portal of darkness then opening before him.
We will meet again, Dragon Knight.
I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, be sure to check out our merch store, Buy Me a Coffee page, and Amazon affiliate link linked in the description and pinned comment below, so you can help us expand the channel and give you guys higher quality content. Also, if you want to check out our original content, be sure to check out the playlists linked in the description below. With all that said and done, I'm JT Anime, and I'll check you guys later.